Okay, so it's time now for a BITCHUTE exclusive. This two-hour video popped up on YouTube, World Health Organization Global Response Pledge Conference convened by the European Union. I'm not going to go through the whole thing, just a few minutes of it. Basically, it's the leaders of the not-so-free world pledging taxpayers' money to vaccine manufacturers and the World Health Organization. And as you can see, the number of dislikes has not been kind to this video. Also, I haven't been able to find any positive comments. You can see for yourself. I think that's very encouraging, as people are watching this and they're seeing right through it.
Over the next months, great minds in laboratories across the world will join forces to defeat the virus. They are doing so as we speak. But victory will take more than great minds. It will take focus. It will take strong international cooperation on vaccines every step of the way. It will also take a firm commitment to multilateral institutions. And it will take resources.
It will take resources, translation money. And as you've heard, this guy has mentioned vaccines. A vaccine for a coronavirus that we now know kills about as many people as the flu kills every year. In America, the CDC recently broke down the number of deaths as of May 2nd in a more transparent manner. For the period between February 1st and May 2nd, 92,615 deaths from pneumonia, flu, and COVID-19. But if you look at the number of deaths from just COVID-19, it's reduced to just 38,576, far lower than the 68,934 deaths currently being reported as COVID-19 deaths in the US via the Johns Hopkins website at the time of making this video. And who knows how much of that 38,000 number is even accurate, given how we know that the categorizing of COVID-19 deaths on death certificates can be very liberal indeed. A coronavirus is going to mutate, and that means that vaccine companies can make a fortune every year from repeat business. A new vaccine for everyone on the planet is a $1 trillion recurring revenue model. It's like snake oil. Also, when have you ever heard Bill Gates or Fauci recommend to the public that they eat well? Plenty of fresh fruit and vegetables, plenty of exercise, sunlight, vitamins and fresh air. You see, there's no money in a healthy population. But there's money in a perpetually sick one, or a population that is so terrified of death that they will take a syringe in the arm every year and demand that it be mandatory.
Thank you, Madam President, Excellencies, dear colleagues and friends. 10 days ago, President von der Leyen, President Macron, Melinda Gates and I launched the SCT Accelerator, a call to action to work together in an unprecedented way to tackle this unprecedented crisis.
Notice that he mentions Melinda Gates.
But the ultimate measure of success will not be how fast we can develop tools. It will be how equally we can distribute them.
In other words, how quickly can we get the vaccine to everyone on the planet?
None of us can accept a world in which some people are protected while others remain exposed.
Translation, it will not be acceptable for some people to not be vaccinated. The vaccine will therefore be mandatory.
This is an opportunity not only to defeat a common enemy, but to forge a common future. A future in which all people enjoy the right to the highest attainable standard of health and the products that deliver that right, health for all.
A brave new world, you might say.
Thank you, Ursula, and good afternoon, everyone. This conference is an expression of one key fact, that global health crisis can only be pushed back through solidarity and through partnerships between governments, strong multilateral organizations, civil society, and the private sector. As long as the virus is active somewhere, we are at risk everywhere.
As long as the virus is active somewhere, we're at risk everywhere. So I think that this is basically the same logic that people use to justify the lockdown. The lockdown and removal of people's fundamental rights may be draconian, but if it even saves one life, this is terrifying logic, because more people will die in lockdown and from economic collapse than from the virus itself. By adopting this totalitarian mindset, you can keep the populace in a state of constant fear. You can justify their enslavement because you're basically saying that death is no longer acceptable to any degree. More people die of car accidents and just as many people die of the flu. So why don't we lock everybody inside and wrap them in bubble wrap forever? That way they'll never have to take another risk for the rest of their lives. If the public adopts this zero tolerance approach to death from COVID-19 or any other pandemic, they will accept slavery.
To protect ourselves, we must in fact protect each other. So today marks a turning point in how we can combat the pandemic. This is the beginning of a global movement barely seen before. Through the partnerships launched today, we will intensify the search for a vaccine.
So you're going to hear these world leaders repeat the same things over and over. Solidarity, we can't leave anyone behind, vaccines, Gavi, pledges to the World Health Organization, etc., etc.
We will strengthen the search for effective treatments and increase our diagnostics capacities. And we will make sure that the achievements are fairly distributed and universally available. These partnerships must also be with us when we recover. We should be guided by the Sustainable Development Goals, including the commitment to leave no one behind.
This leave no one behind policy means everyone must take the vaccine. And this is basically stated in the 2018 World Health Organization document that I've previously read. Immunization today and in the next decade, 2018 assessment report of the Global Vaccine Action Plan. Just to briefly go through some of it in the introduction, the Global Vaccine Action Plan, launched in 2011, set out goals and objectives for the immunization community for the decade to 2020. Its vision was of a world in which all individuals and communities enjoy lives free from vaccine-preventable diseases. And it also says, there will never come a point at which immunization is no longer required. Also, the 2017 article from the World Health Organization website, which I've previously mentioned, which was authored by Dr. Margaret Chan, former Director General, World Health Organization, Chris Elias, President of the Global Development Program at the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, Anthony Fauci, Director of the U.S. National Institute of Allergies and Infectious Diseases, Anthony Lake, Executive Director of UNICEF, Seth Berkley, Chief Executive Officer of Gavi, the Vaccine Alliance. And the title of the article is Reaching Everyone Everywhere with Life-Saving Vaccines. The plan was always to forcibly vaccinate the planet, but you can't do so if the virus is only about as deadly as the flu and mostly only kills the same demographic of people who die from the flu. Because if most people knew that, they wouldn't see the justification for a mandatory vaccine. So they had to force everybody into lockdown and quarantine, and then generate media fear-mongering and bogus data models and manipulated death certificates to create a fake crisis that they sold to the world as the next big Spanish flu, quarantining healthy people who would never need to actually take a vaccine, and this was all done in order to market the idea of a mandatory annual vaccine along with a digital immunity ID. That's ID 2020. And slowly, the media and politicians are sowing the seeds of this new world to the populace.
Multilateral cooperation is more important than ever. So we pledge an additional 50 million kroners to the World Health Organization. Furthermore, we commit to support global COVID-19 efforts directed to the poorest and the most vulnerable. We will develop a detail on our response in the coming weeks and months. Norway funds the development of a vaccine through CEPI and will increase our support with $220 million, and we'll do so together with other committed states and actors. But as we all know, developing the tools only gets us halfway. In order to save lives, vaccines, treatment and diagnostic tools must be made available to all. Gavi plays a vital role in making vaccines, including a COVID-19 vaccine, when ready, available to poor countries and to vulnerable groups. So Norway pledges $1 billion to Gavi for the next strategic period.
Holy crap! Norway just pledged $1 billion to Gavi. The Gates Foundation pledged $750 million to set up Gavi back in 1999. This is from the Gavi website. And according to Wikipedia, the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation has donated $1.56 billion to the alliance's 2016 to 2020 strategic period, as of March 2019. As you probably remember, Gavi is one of several partners behind the ID 2020 project, including Accenture, Microsoft, IDEO.org, and Rockefeller Foundation. Anyway, I'm going to move on now to Justin Trudeau of Canada.
Obviously, we know we can't get back to full normal until we develop vaccines, and that's why Canada and so many countries around the world and scientists and researchers are pushing hard to develop a vaccine for COVID-19, and we're happy to support in those initiatives here at home and around the world. But it's going to take more than just finding a vaccine. It's going to need production of that vaccine so we can reach billions of people around the world.
Billions of people around the world. Is it starting to sink in yet? Have you been reading between the lines, dear viewer? They're telling you it's going to be mandatory. You're not going to be allowed to live a normal life and be in large public settings until you're vaccinated. And until you can prove that you are.
In an equitable fashion, we can't just have the wealthiest countries, the most successful scientific countries have this success and not share it with the world, because we will not be safe until we're able to share it with the world. That is why this acceleration for tools of COVID on vaccine development, on treatment, on testing, is such an important initiative, and why I'm so happy that we are all a part of this. Canada is proud to be a part of this. Our contribution of more than $850 million includes significant investments in Canadian medical research and development. It also includes contributions to international vaccine development through the Coalition for Epidemic Preparedness in Innovations, funding for the WHO's work on treatment, and of course, support for developing countries. We cannot do this without thinking about the world at the same time.
Anyway, let's move on now to Britain's Boris Johnson.
To win this battle, we must work together to build an impregnable shield around all our people. And that can only be achieved by developing and mass producing a vaccine.
Again, just a reminder that recent studies from Santa Clara County and LA County show that this virus is only about as deadly as a seasonal flu. But apparently, we now need a vaccine for this thing. This is a scam, and it is an attempt to bring about complete control and authoritarianism. The people behind this are the enemies of humanity, and they wish to strip all of us of our freedoms. They've already taken away our rights, restricted our movements. They now want to surveil us, to track us with contact tracers and apps. They've destroyed people's livelihoods, put millions of people out of jobs, destroyed small businesses, and jeopardized the futures of billions of people. I wish what I was saying was just hyperbole, but it's true. Wake up. Very dark things are coming if people don't wise up soon and fight this future that the psycho oligarchs want for us. Anyway, here's what Prime Minister of Italy Giuseppe Conte said.
We'll contribute 10 million euros to CEPI to accelerate research to find a vaccine. We also contribute 10 million euros to the World Health Organization to continue supporting the most vulnerable countries in the preparedness and the response to COVID-19. We will allocate half a million euros to COVID-19 response mechanism of the Global Fund. And finally, since distributing vaccines safely and effectively must be our common priority, we commit to contribute 120 million euros over the next, say, 5 years to Gavi.
And here's the president of the Swiss Confederation.
Firstly, as one of the leading hubs for medical, pharmaceutical, and health technology innovation, Switzerland welcomes the emphasis placed by this conference on equitable access to diagnostics, treatments, and vaccines. We believe in the need to integrate this perspective into all projects aimed at fighting the pandemic. Let us leave no one behind.
Don't be left behind. Take your vaccine, because the people who do will be allowed to get on with their lives. The people who don't, they won't be allowed to live a normal life, and they'll be treated like second-class citizens.
Don't ask questions. Just take the vaccine and get excited for next vaccines.
Lastly, I am glad to announce that Switzerland will devote more than 350 million euros towards international efforts to combat the pandemic and its consequences. Half of the amount will go to the International Committee of the Red Cross to help reduce the humanitarian impact of the pandemic. Up to 160 million euros will be devoted to further supporting international efforts to combat the COVID-19 crisis, notably towards research and development on diagnostics, treatment and vaccines, and further humanitarian needs. The Swiss government will decide on these contributions in the coming weeks. Close to 20 million euros has already been allocated to CEPI, to the WHO and other global health organizations in this field.
Again, it's all taxpayers' money. Nobody gets to vote on this stuff any more than they got a say on whether they could opt in or out of the lockdown or the social distancing policies or other restrictions. What makes you think these people will give you a choice whether or not you can take the vaccine? So let's move on to Mark Rutte of the Netherlands.
We are contributing 50 million euros for the rapid development of a vaccine through the Coalition for Epidemic Preparedness Innovations.
It's like they're all singing from the same hymn sheet.
42 million euros for dedicated COVID-19 medical research and development programs. 50 million euros for prevention and humanitarian aid. 40 million euros for economic stability via IMF and UN mechanisms.
The global economy has been effectively shut down. Millions of people out of work, and they're on a spending spree. Add to that the amount of social welfare being handed out to people across the world. How is any of this going to be paid back? Imagine the massive increases in taxes in order to pay for all of this.
And 10 million euros for additional support to the Global Financing Facility to be used to aid low-income countries in fighting this pandemic. The Netherlands is also a long-standing partner of Gavi. We will carefully consider our future contribution and we look forward to the Gavi third donor pledging conference hosted by the UK government on June the 4th.
Okay, let's move on.
And now I'm happy to welcome a message from one of our partner organizations. The Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation is an inspiring example how philanthropists can help a global cause.
Ah, the Gates Foundation. Who could ever have seen this coming?
I'm very delighted to introduce a message from Melinda Gates.
Right now, the world is counting on its scientists, the people operating electron microscopes and conducting clinical trials in hopes of developing a drug or a vaccine.
I think given that this virus isn't as dangerous as we were initially told, we can safely rely on things like sunlight, vitamin C and D, exercise, good diet, a generally healthy lifestyle instead. Does anyone really think that Melinda or her husband Bill are actually going to take this vaccine themselves?
Because that's what it's going to take to beat this pandemic. Breakthrough science.
Bollocks! The virus isn't that big a problem, and as Dr. Newt Witkowski pointed out, the herd immunity route would have killed this thing off in a few weeks.
But we must remember, that's not all it will take. For life to get back to normal, we also need to call on our common humanity.
Oh, jeez. When they start saying stuff like common humanity, it's really creepy. Common humanity, show me your humanity. I don't think you've got a shred of it. These people want to treat the world's population like cattle, to be terrified into compliance, locked down in their homes, their rights and freedoms removed. They want us tagged, monitored, and controlled. These people are the greatest threat humanity has ever faced.
COVID-19 has reminded us that viruses don't obey borders or customs laws. They don't care about what nationality you are. So long as COVID-19 is somewhere, COVID-19 can spread anywhere. So what will it take to end this pandemic?
Firstly, border control would have stopped a virus from China, but the intention seemed to have been to allow this virus to spread globally in order to create a problem that you and your husband claim to have a solution for. But of course, the virus isn't even as deadly as all of you are making it out to be. What will it take to stop the pandemic? is the human immune system and herd immunity. For that, we must first end the lockdown and this bullshit social distancing, which is really just human distancing and a form of control. It's divide and conquer.
Well, it will take more than making a vaccine available to the very highest bidder. It's going to take more than delivering it only to people in wealthy nations. The pandemic won't end until people everywhere can be immunized against it.
See? She's telling you that life will not return to normal until everyone is vaccinated against it. Again, it feels like we're being held at syringe point.
Until everyone can benefit from the world's science, regardless of where they live. That's what this effort is about. By combining the world's expertise and brain power and resources, we can attack this disease in the way it's attacking us, globally. And by working together, we can beat it much faster than if we were working alone. Our foundation is proud to partner with you, and I'm pleased to announce today that we will pledge $100 million towards this effort. I want to thank the President of the European Commission, Ursula von der Leyen, for making this event happen. And I want to thank all the leaders involved for their generosity.
For their generosity? It's not their money, it's taxpayers' money. They're giving that money on behalf of citizens. And without our consent. And by the way, no one elected you. Who even are you to be saying this to us? This video is so creepy and unbelievably sinister. It's like I'm watching some propaganda from some dystopian movie or something. It's a bunch of tyrannical world leaders and so-called philanthropists telling you they're here to help, lying to our faces about a virus that's no more deadly than a seasonal flu, and all while stealing taxpayers' money to line the pockets of more unelected wealthy global oligarchs who want to control every aspect of our lives and introduce a mark of the beast system. Anyway, I'm going to move on now to Ireland's Leo Varadkar.
Hello, Leo Varadkar here, Taoiseach Prime Minister of Ireland, speaking to you from Dublin. Excellencies, as we all know, viruses don't respect borders and don't recognise countries.
What a dumb thing to say. Yes, viruses can be kept out by borders, because they travel from person to person. Viruses can't book flights from Wuhan by themselves.
And this virus, the coronavirus, is a shared enemy of all of humanity and all governments. The only way we can defeat a global threat is by working together on a multilateral basis, and Ireland and the European Union are committed to doing exactly that.
Good Lord, this guy is wooden. How are you supposed to convince anyone of what you're saying, Leo, when you don't even sound like you believe it?
Working together, we can develop an effective vaccine, effective treatments, testing systems that work, diagnostics and therapeutics. And in doing this, Ireland wants to play its part. So far, we've already contributed $60 million in direct or repurposed grants, enabling our UN and other partners to respond rapidly to the situation on the ground. And as part of that, we've quadrupled our funding to the World Health Organization to $9.5 million.
While America has recently ceased all funding to the World Health Organization, Ireland quadruples its funding to the World Health Organization. What a disaster. These people are crooks.
Today, on behalf of the Irish people, I'm announcing a new pledge of €18 million to Gavi, G-A-V-I, the Vaccine Alliance.
Are you noticing a pattern here, dear viewer?
This will be paid over the course of the next 5 years, so that the poorest countries in the world will have access to the COVID-19 vaccine, if and when it's developed. This is part of the European Union's comprehensive effort to fight COVID-19. We're also going to harness the capabilities of our research sector, our world-class universities and pharmaceutical companies, and will co-finance a public-private partnership in immunology research in this area, valued up to €10 million over the next 3 years. Sooner or later, we will defeat this virus. We'll develop the vaccine that prevents it and the medicines that treat it. And it's really important that nobody in the world is left out when that happens. Thank you very much.
It's really important that nobody in the world is left out when that happens. Anyway, you can watch the full video linked below. It's very long. It's over 2 hours. Thanks very much for watching this exclusive BitChute video. Please share it because obviously my platform here on BitChute is much smaller than on YouTube. So sharing this video means a great deal, and hopefully we can get it to reach as many people as possible. Take care, and I'll see you next time. Bye-bye.